Before I get into this video, I want to talk briefly about today's sponsor, the Exter Smart Wallet. Exter have kindly given me a 20% discount code to share with you guys, Walshie20. The Exter is a smart wallet that's convenient, stylish, and trackable. No longer do you need to fumble about for money or cards, as the wallet is incredibly compact and you can easily access cards with a click of a button. I'd even say it's as easy to use as a hidden blade. Okay, not the best comparison, but you see what I mean. The wallet is totally secure, not just in the sense that your cards won't fall out, but you can also get a tracker card, meaning it's totally trackable. The tracker is really small and fits in really easily, and it can hold up to 3 months of battery life. Also worth mentioning is the wallet is super compact. It's smaller than most phones and fits comfortably in your pocket. And on top of being so compact and so convenient, the wallet is made of premium leather that comes in a variety of colors. If you guys are interested in picking yourself up one of these very versatile wallets, I'll leave a link to Exter's site in the description, and if you do want to pick one of these up, you can use code Walshie20 for 20% off. And with that said, onto today's video. So the other day, I finished probably my 8th or so playthrough of Assassin's Creed Origins and thought I'd put together a review of the game. It's a game I totally love, and I thought it'd be interesting now more than ever to talk about Assassin's Creed's first RPG and see if in hindsight it's held up just as well as I thought. Of course, everything said in this video is just an opinion. You're as entitled to yours as I am mine, so with that said, let's review Assassin's Creed Origins 3 years on. To put things into perspective, Assassin's Creed Origins was probably one of the most hyped games in the entire series. Many people were burnt out by Unity and or Syndicate, there were some outliers, but most were, and a lot of people had sort of lost faith in the series. However, as early as January 2016, rumours began spreading about a new game, one set in Egypt, and we go on to learn that it would be headed by game director Ashraf Ismail and creative director John Gasdon, the same people behind AC4, and that inspired a lot of hope. Over more than a year and a half of waiting, so much hype was built up for this game. It was already being called the revival of AC prior to its release, and we couldn't wait to see what the team had in store for us in this new RPG take on the series. So anyway, you open the game, and you get this. I still get chills just loading this game. It takes me back to playing this on the midnight of the game's release. The main menu theme is just amazing. Anyway, you open up the game properly and are greeted with this pre-rendered opening cutscene akin to the one we got in Revelations, albeit not narrated and with far more letterboxing. It's cool, it's a nice introduction to Siwa and the calm before the storm, but you all know the best part of this intro already.
You are the Magi from Siwa. I thought Magi was supposed to protect the Pharaoh.
I am Magi to no Pharaoh. You see this?
I can read my own name, Nat. We will find you. We will find you in your sleep.
Sleep. I never sleep. I just wait in the shadows, and I will kill you all. Everyone who sniffed the air that day in Siwa!
This scene is honestly one of my favourites in the entire series. Everything about it is perfect. Abubakar Salim sells every single part of it, and Bayek might just be the best performed character in the entire series. Every single inflection feels perfect. Bayek has such a presence in this scene, which is only heightened by Sarah Schachman's score. It's such a great hook into the game. I feel having a good introduction is crucial to any game, more so AC, and every time I see this I get really hyped for what's to come, and it's far more engaging than just your basic tutorial. Speaking of tutorials, that's what we get next in a fight with Reject's bodyguard, which is the first time we use Origins' combat system, which is one that I like. It's not my ideal AC combat system, far from it, but just as a combat system, it is good. Up to this point, we had hand systems, which while good, could feel a little scripted, and could range from being engaging to Syndicate's combat system, which is so painful and mind-numbing, it's basically the video game equivalent of doing your taxes while suffering from a severe case of shingles. Origins isn't like that though. Enemies don't wait for one another, and if you see a group of 7 or 8 guards headed your way, it doesn't just feel like you'll have a longer fight, but a much harder, near impossible one. I really appreciate the fact we also have a huge variety of weapons that genuinely play differently to one another. In Syndicate, we had three weapon types that all played the same, but Origins gives you regular swords, sickle swords, double daggers, blunt heavy weapons, heavy bladed weapons, spears, and scepters. What this means is that what weapon you use defines your speed, whether you can equip a shield, your reach, how well you can break an enemy's defense, everything really. It's not like other games where I can call the combat fast or slow, because it's whatever you want to make it really. The game allows for you to basically have your own playstyle, and you aren't punished for not using a certain style of combat because they're all equally viable. I usually went with something heavier, usually alternating between a scepter or an axe, because you've got a nice reach and a lot of power, with the only downside being you're a little slow. Each weapon also has its own attributes, things like heal on hit, combo multipliers, things that you'd expect from an RPG. And if you get attached to a particular weapon or shield, you don't have to worry about, say, outgrowing them, because all you have to do is upgrade them as you level up. The problems I do have with the combat system are that sometimes you'll be hit and you'll just stand stunned, probably longer than you actually should. It's also far from the best looking and the best feeling combat, as you can feel a bit too heavy at times, even with the lighter weapons, so sometimes there'll be somewhat clunky fights, but on the whole, the combat is good. After that fight, you fall through the floor, and after killing the bodyguard, you have to navigate your way out of this tomb, I suppose it is, where we're introduced to the traversal, which, to be honest, is one of my two major issues with the game. Traversal is one of the most important things in Assassin's Creed, and one of the elements of the series that makes it so special. At its best, an Assassin's Creed traversal system should give you choice, prioritizing control and agency before looks. It should be accessible, but shouldn't hold your hand, and I really like a sense of risk for reward, where using parkour is faster than moving through a densely populated place, but is more difficult or is going to punish you for making mistakes. In Origins, you don't get that. Instead, we get the weakest parkour of any game in the series, a system with zero depth that has no learning curve. For one, practically anything is climbable, and bar a few exceptions, you don't get any minor or major climbing puzzles, and it feels totally unengaging, especially when climbing taller structures. All your momentum goes upwards, and there's no sprint button in the game, so you're sort of just constantly jogging and generally moving slowly, and in general, it all feels very basic and the kind of parkour system you get in a game where parkour is secondary, and it kind of is here, which is a huge shame to be honest, and is perhaps Origin's biggest flaw. After that sequence, you meet Hepzifer, Bike's friend, and you fight off some more guards before heading back to Siwa, Bike's home. On the journey, you learn of the Order of Ancients who Bike is hunting. Hepzifer tells us of a garrison Ptolemy sent to Siwa, also learning of Mudunamud, the Ibis, a member of the Order who's oppressing Siwa, and your first big goal is to kill him. Before that though, you get an introduction to two things, hunting and Senu. Hunting was quite a nice feature that gave you a little more to do in terms of side content and genuinely rewarded you for exploring the world and the game's wildlife, so I do like it. Senu, on the other hand, is something I'm not so big on, more so in hindsight. Rather than eagle vision, we get a literal eagle who Bayek can send off to mark targets for him. I suppose Senu was a way of embracing the RPG format, but it's a weird replacement for one of the series' most iconic features that doesn't really make any sense. We can assume Bayek isn't a furtive descendant as the apple doesn't react to him, but there's literally no explanation for this. We were told before Origins the feature would be explained properly, but it's just sort of left it, well, they have a close bond, therefore she can communicate with Bayek. It doesn't make any sense, and it's a bit weird, but worse than that is the fact it's became a series mainstay, with us having Icaros in Odyssey and soon to be Sunin in Valhalla, and I hope it ends there, as it seems so stupid for every protagonist to just have a supernatural eagle just by coincidence, and I know the reflection of that is why don't you buy that when the series has Apples of Eden and a precursor race, and the issue isn't that it's unrealistic, that's fine, it's more that it's totally unexplained. It's yet another massive gap in the AC lore that really doesn't need to be there. Anyway, with that to one side, we actually can't kill Mudunamun just yet as we aren't a high enough level, instead having to do side quests out and about Siwa to get XP. Let's talk about the side quests a bit. I don't think they're really that good on the whole. There's a few that stick out, like the one where you save a woman's husband, that was quite funny. There was the one where you fight with the old Street Fighter, the Claridus one was kind of interesting, hearing more about Siwa, and there's probably two to three others I remember enjoying. The thing is, to remember about six side quests in a game that requires you to do maybe 40 to 50 is quite bad. I played the game without New Game Plus probably three other times besides this, and for two of those, I ended up just playing a podcast or something else while doing these because they're so dull. This time though, I didn't do that. Every single side quest I did, I paid my full attention to, gave them a chance, and I still didn't enjoy almost all of these. They mostly revolve around you going to a base, freeing someone, or stealing something, and when you need to do as many as you do, it gets boring really quick. Anyway, speaking of bases, let's talk a bit about the stealth. I'll touch more on side quests in a bit. The biggest addition to stealth in Origins is the bow. We've had projectiles and firearms in the past, but none have been as versatile or probably as useful as your bow. There's four bows, your run-of-the-mill hunter bow, a warrior bow that works a bit like a shotgun, the elite bow that lets you sort of burst fire these weaker shots, and also a predator bow, which you carry significantly less ammo for before, but the shots are very powerful and you can actually control the direction of your arrow. I like the choice of multiple bows. I always go with my best hunter bow for normal stealth, and then in the second slot maybe a light or maybe warrior bow for, you know, close quarters sort of combat. You can also improve various stealth abilities using the new skill tree, or even your combat abilities, or just various other abilities for that matter. Again, it's another thing that was sort of a given with the series becoming an RPG, and Ubisoft have played with the idea of a skill tree, you know, a few years before Origins, but they fully went in here. You get a skill point every time you level up, and it's fairly standard stuff, although I must say I much preferred unlocking abilities as you progress through the narrative though. Take unlocking the hidden gun with Ezio by using the codex. That was far more satisfying than just going to the menu and pressing X. It's okay, I just don't really feel too strongly about the skill tree. In terms of the actual stealth, you've still got the crouch button, however instead of a more cover-based system like we had in Syndicate and Unity, we have bushes back like the ones in Black Flag. The biggest complaint you'll see about the stealth in the community is the fact that hidden blade kills aren't one-shots, and that's my least favourite thing about the stealth honestly, that despite not being far off in level, or in some cases the same level, hidden blade kills aren't insta-kills and neither are headshots. I've said this a few times in various other videos, but I feel as if stealth is about rewarding smarter play, giving you, the assassin, an advantage if you move discreetly, and that fits in well thematically too. So making it so that using the hidden blade not only won't kill the enemy, but will alert them of your location and allow them to alert other guards is a terrible decision. I understand having level gaps that change the amount of damage you can both deal and take in regular combat, but in terms of stealth, it makes things far worse. I should also mention Origins is the first AC to feature difficulty settings. I usually play the game on normal, although I've played once on Nightmare, and that was a good time too. You can also level scale enemies if you play a new game plus so things aren't too easy for you, and that's also nice. I usually go for missions 2 levels above where I was because things weren't too hard and I had to spend less time doing side quests and more time actually progressing. Speaking of progressing, we're now like 10 minutes into the video and haven't even reached the first assassination, so now we've gone over like the main features of the game, we can get more into the narrative. So anyway, Bayek assassinates Madunamun, taking us into Origins' first confession, and it's different to say the least. Instead of going for a more typical kind of memory corridor, you have these really trippy sequences that are far more symbolic than anything, and I really like these. Instead of having your target on their last breath, Bayek will have these huge arguments and character moments, and it's yet another chance for Abubakar Slim's excellent acting to shine through. In this sequence, we get a flashback showing us Bayek with his son Hemu, as well as his friend Chenzara, and we get to see Bayek's fatherliness and this paternal instinct he has, which is one of Bayek's most likeable traits. Anyway, Bayek goes with Chenzara and his son, AC Revenge Trope number 34, or 35, I don't know, I've sort of lost count by now, to hunt hyenas. We get a really nice moment with Bayek and Hemu where he introduces him to the Leap of Faith. It's a really cool bit of fan service and a really cool way of introducing this thing that's iconic to AC, but it genuinely serves as a really nice scene between the two. Anyway, Chenzara gets captured by the Order of Ancients, and so do Bayek and Hemu after going after him. They take them to a vault beneath Siwa and explain that the orb will somehow open this vault. The orb is just an apple of Eden, it's apple 2, the one Al-Walim gets in AC1, and it's in the truth of AC2, and the Order insists Bayek must know something about opening the vault, which he doesn't, and they're left alone and told to open the vault, which is when Hemu steals a knife so Bayek can cut himself free, and we get an incredible scene.
Tell us!
No, I don't know.
We must go now.
I will cut the heart from the boy.
No, wait.
He will never know the afterlife.
No, I will tell you!
Stalling for time! What's this? Stop! This is madness! The snake takes that as your answer.
Yeah! No! No! Come on!
This again solidifies how great and how well acted of a character Bayek is. Hemu's death isn't itself the saddest thing in this scene for me, but the desperation of a father trying so hard to save the life of his son, and him, in his anger, inadvertently killing him. And after this, we cut back to the confession, where we get yet another brilliant scene.
Son, you are no one. Bayek of nothing, father to nobody!
And here is your nobody!
Ah!
May the Hidden One greet you. The Lord of the Duat awaits.
Seeing Bayek lash out at Medunamon like this is totally understandable. This is a man now overtaken by grief with very little left. It's the kind of totally human story that I love to see from Assassin's Creed, and I love Bayek's character because he feels so real. After this, Bayek heads back to Hepzifer with the apple and tells him he's leaving for Alexandria to go and meet Aya, his wife, who's also been hunting members of the Order, but before we can go, we get our first look at Origins Modern Day. I still remember how excited I was as this loading screen played for a totally new Modern Day, one we knew that Bishop wasn't involved in, that hopefully would matter and make the Monday important again. Bit optimistic that was, but what we got definitely was an improvement at the very least. For one, we're an actual character, maybe not a good one, but better than literally nothing. It's also playable and there's not just gaps in the story as there was with Syndicates, but with that said, it's inconsequential enough where I can feel I can discuss the whole thing in one segment. First of all, Layla. Layla's not an interesting character in Origins and still isn't now. She's a bit annoying, to be honest, and is just sort of a host for you to use in the modern day. In terms of the story, not much really happens. Layla's mate dies, she's not too happy about that apparently. William Miles shows up, but he might as well just not have done. There's a gap between Origins and Odyssey's Modern Day because for some reason Ubisoft want to keep the Modern Day in the present, so it's quite pointless here, and William just, as I say, he might as well not have shown up. It's got better groundwork than the two that came before it, but what it does with that and everything Modern Day related is so meaningless, it really just doesn't matter. It's quite disappointing that there was this chance for the Modern Day to actually be given some new life, but Ubisoft haven't really cared about it in years, so it's not too much of a surprise. Anyway, back to the actual story, Bayek leaves Siwa, which serves as sort of the tutorial area in the game, and on your way you get this really beautiful moment as you make your way over the dunes and see Yamu and Alexandria off in the distance. I mentioned this in my top 5 cities video, but Origins has so many of these unscripted moments where parts of the world are revealed to you, and this is one of those. It's really nice, and because the story takes you there, you can tell it's at least somewhat intentional, but there'll be times where you'll just be taken aback by the beauty of Egypt just doing your own thing. It's not as good now, because if you bought the DLC, you get bombarded with all of these pop-ups. I can't imagine how confusing it'd be if you just bought the game with the season pass today, and then in this really momentous moment you get a letter about the Hidden Ones being slaughtered in the Sinai. Like, that'd be a bit weird. But either way, it's still a really cool moment and it doesn't ruin it or anything. Anyway, the quest where you kill Medunamon is a recommended level 5, and the quest where you meet Aya is a recommended level 10 one. It doesn't take as much XP to level up at this point, but it's the first considerably long gap between main missions. At this point, I wasn't fully exhausted by side missions, so I went from level 6 all the way to 10, instead of leaving the usual 2 level gap as I did later on. But at this point, it really doesn't take you that long to get XP, and it took me maybe an hour or a little bit more to get leveled up to where I need to be. You have this side quest with Menahesh, where you get to see a lighter side of Bayek, and that's quite nice after so much heavy stuff. After that, we meet Aya and Alexandria, where her and Bayek embrace in a really sweet moment, and of course that's when Bayek turns on a bit of the old sweet talk.
I bludgeoned Medunamon with this, if I am honest. I took pleasure in it.
Ah, oh, Bayek, you are fucking useless, mate. Basically, Aya has killed 2 members of the Order already, working with Cleopatra, whose throne was used out by her brother Ptolemy XIII, with the help of the Order of Ancients, who he still works with. So Bayek, Aya, and Cleopatra have common ground in that they want the Order dead. Cleopatra even gave Aya a hidden blade to use. Where she got it, we still don't know. I mean, it's implied it's Darius's, but there's still a big gap there. As a singular experience, having this weapon be given to Bayek wouldn't be much of a plot hole, but as a franchise, it feels like a huge loose end. Anyway, the next assassination is on Gennadios. Gennadios is the leader of the Phylakatai, who are basically like an Egyptian police force led by the Pharaoh, and they've been sent after Aya for assassinating another member of the Order. This assassination is nothing too special, but after killing Gennadios, you have the Phylakis hunt you down. They range in level from about 15 to maybe 45, and what's cool is that if they're in the area when a brazier is lit, they'll come after you. They're sort of mini boss fights and make for some cool post-game content, and they're basically the closest we've gotten to a decent notoriety system since AC4, and that's something that I really miss, so I think the Phylakis are a great addition. The next assassination is on Eudorus, the snake, the man who Bayek thought killed Hemu, or pushed him into Hemu, however you want to see it. As forgettable as Eudorus is, this is probably my favourite assassination in the game. Instead of just sending you to another copy and paste fort, you go into this bathhouse that makes it feel far more special than just a regular bandit camp. I know that it's dead easy, as you'll see by my gameplay, and you'll know if you've played the game, but the assassinations have been lacking recently, and this is one of the only good ones, even if it is only in terms of the atmosphere. So you assassinate Eudorus, and Bayek loses a finger by using the blade. It's not what started the ritual of removing your ring finger, but it's a nice little nod to that, even if Bayek does shake it off, which to be honest just sort of makes it funny to me. But yeah, after that, Bayek and I have another moment where they really just get off to murder again? I don't know why they do that. It scares me a bit. Let's move past it. Byte gets sent to meet Apollodorus by Aya because he needs to know if Eudorus really was the last member. And Apollodorus basically knows everything, but lo and behold, Apollodorus needs the measure of Byte and sends him to recover a scroll and save a hostage. It's a bit annoying having to progress through these sorts of tasks in side missions to actually experience the story, just to have what feels like another boring side quest in a main mission. But once you've done this, the story continues. He takes us to his estate to meet Cleopatra, who's determined, charismatic, and self-serving above all else, which I suppose does make sense historically. She wants Byte to pledge himself to her, although he doesn't really care for politics and declines. However, after finding out about there being more members of the Order, he reconsiders. We get a scene telling us about the hyena, scarab, lizard, and crocodile, also learning the snake means the Order of Ancients and Eudorus was just another member. Byte soon changes his mind and becomes Cleopatra's Magi in a really cool scene. Although, this line does always crack me up.
It is time for assassinations.
Like, yeah. We get it, it's an AC game, well done. But yeah, after that you get sent off to assassinate these four targets, and this is basically the section where you're let free in the world. SeaWorld was the tutorial section, and Alexandria is a lot of exposition and still feels very much like the start, but now we're let free in Egypt, it doesn't feel like that anymore. So with that in mind, let's talk about Egypt. It's one of my favourite worlds the series has given us, and a lot of that is because everywhere feels alive. It's never as if the big cities where the story happens are where all the attention is put and everywhere else is just neglected, because every corner of the world feels living. This was the first game with life cycles too, and I think that made a big impact as well. The environments are all great too. I mean, like the actual environments, like the outskirts of Giza, for example, are beautiful, and nothing ever feels too samey. With locations like Cyrene, Siwa, Alexandria, and Giza being so different, the game feels far more alive in exchange. And I know I keep saying the word alive, but that's really how the world feels, and it's spectacular, really. So now Byte has a new list of targets he can get to work. And by get to work, I mean he can once he's a high enough level. You know what, I'm going to stop mentioning the whole side quest thing for these four targets. You probably played the game and know it's annoying, but with that said, I think there's something of a silver lining. I think a lot of these quests feel fitting of Byte. He's a Magi and an all-round man of the people, so he is going to want to do a lot of these things. It doesn't excuse so many of these breaking up the narrative or being repetitive, but that's sort of what kept me going. The first, and by far the best villain you'll come across, is the Scarab. I think he's genuinely quite a good villain and is far more memorable than even the main antagonist. Basically, there's this guy, Tahaka, who's trying to rebuild Letopolis, a city buried beneath the sands. He's a charismatic family man, and he is quite likable, but as it turns out, he was the Scarab the whole time, even having his father-in-law's tongue cut off because he knew of his identity. It's not the most compelling story, but there's a wrench thrown in there, and it's more interesting than the other targets. He poisons Byte and leaves him to die, buried in the sands. Senu helps him out a bit, and we kill the first of our four new targets. This one, it's pretty good. After this, we go into a naval mission with Aya, which is jarring, I suppose. Basically, Cleopatra has sent Aya to get Pompey to ally with her, since Pompey historically was allied with her father, Ptolemy XII. The naval itself is okay, I'd say it's better than Odyssey's, there's definitely more weight to it, but it's not quite as good as Black Flag's. I suppose it doesn't have to be, given it's far more significant in that game, but it just sort of feels like it's here out of obligation when it really doesn't have to be. And the novelty of the naval in this game just sort of wears off after the first mission. It's weird to think naval's been featured in just a little less than half of the games in the series, but it really doesn't have to be if it's not necessary, and I feel it overstays its welcome here, as by the third or even second naval mission, it gets a bit boring. Anyway, after Aya wins over Pompey, we go back to Byte. Byte's next target is the hyena, who's decent, I suppose, as she's far more sympathetic than the other members of the Order. She was sent to hunt silica, as that would help power first civ weapons the Order wanted, but ended up deciding she'd use the technology for herself to resurrect her daughter. It's genuinely quite sad seeing this distressed, grieving woman who's lost a child, just leaving her in total desperation. It's a nice mirror to Byte, and I like that he's sympathetic to it. It reminds us he's not just a cold killer, but a man with his own very similar tragic motivations. After that, we have to assassinate the crocodile. Or we don't, we need to assassinate the lizard. But you didn't think about that, did you? Because nobody remembers the lizard. The lizard is terrible. Basically, the character Passion Remta is the High Priest, and because the lizard wants that position for himself, he tries to damage his reputation by making the city ill. He does that, but soon enough you figure out what's going on, and assassinate him. There's not really much memorable about the lizard, and that's about the extent of what there is to say about him, so instead, we'll move on to the longest thread of missions hunting a target, that target being the crocodile. Byte meets with one of Apollodorus's informants, Hotefer, Hotafres, you also meet his wife Henu and daughter Shadir. Basically, before this, Hotafres had this ledger with evidence of the crocodile's identity. However, the crocodile sent mercenaries to attack their house, by which time Henu had escaped with the ledger. When we meet up with Henu, she tells us where she hid it in their villa, and Shadir shows us the way, with some fairly cute dialogue again showing us Bike's true nature as a parent. We go to the villa and discover Shadir had the ledger all along. After returning to Henu, we find her missing and discover that her and Shadir were taken to the lighthouse, and it becomes fairly obvious what's happened. Shadir's death on a first playthrough was sad, but now it just feels a bit baity, I suppose. Like, playing it now, it's fairly obvious where it's going from the beginning. Anyway, we learn that Shadir was taken by two gladiators, so we go to the gladiator arena in Crocodilopolis, which is still the coolest name for anything ever. After doing a few side quests you have to do because there's another level gap, I said I'd stop bitching about that, didn't I? But yeah, basically, while you're up there, you meet Kensa, an old friend of Bayek's from Siwa, and I genuinely really enjoy the second half of the crocodile story, because I do like Kensa quite a bit, and the actual gameplay and missions are quite fun. You find out the men who took Henu and Shadir are actually of quite high esteem, the Gallic brothers, two legendary fighters, and so you and Kensa have to fight your way up to their level so you can fight them. Before one of the fights, we find out Kensa is working for someone secret. Bayek obviously has a feeling it's the crocodile, but she doesn't want to talk about it. Soon enough, you fight the brothers, which is a pretty cool boss fight, and after defeating them, they tell you of the crocodile's identity, a woman named Berenike, who Kensa was indeed working for. Despite Berenike being a bit of a nothing villain, she genuinely has quite a good confession, as you see Bayek truly angry about Shadir, and again, it's brilliantly acted by Abubakar Salim. The way that I feel about the story in this game is that it starts, then pauses when you leave Alexandria, then starts again after the crocodile was killed. Hunting the targets in this game is far more separate than it usually was, despite being quite important in the grand scheme of things. In other games in the series, you'd have this overarching narrative where characters would develop or big things would happen while you assassinated targets, whereas here, it's sort of like everything is on hold. Don't get me wrong, there's some good moments in these missions with Bayek, but when these are their own mini-stories separated in and of themselves by arbitrary side quests, it makes this section of the game, which is about half of it, feel far, far weaker than what comes before or after it. Anyway, the next important thing that happens is Bayek goes to meet Cleopatra, having killed those four targets, only to find out there's two more members of the Order out there, the Jackal and the Scorpion. We also learn an attempt was made on Cleopatra's life at the command of Septimius. He also works with the Order, as well as the Gabinianis, a 2,000-man militia, basically giving us a few new targets. I really like the next section. You slowly uncover this plot against Cleopatra. There's political intrigue and assassinations. It feels very much like old AC as you slowly unravel and stop this plan. You return to the palace where you meet Aya, although the Gabinianis are sent in regardless, and you fight them off. Cleopatra is clearly quite frustrated by this point and is getting impatient waiting for her throne, and sends us to go and meet Pompey, our ally we gained earlier. On the way, Aya and Bayek converse, where it's clear the last year took a significant toll on their relationship, which is understandable really. The only thing that seems to have bound these two very broken people is their son's death, the event that broke him in the first place, and the cracks start to show here. When the two arrive at Pompey's camp, you find that him and his men were slaughtered by Septimius. It's at this point Cleopatra decides to meet up with Caesar, who's in Alexandria at the time. You get another naval mission fighting off Ptolemy's men, but reach the city all the same. Of course, Cleopatra can't just walk into Ptolemy's palace, so you end up posing as merchants and wrapping her up in a rug. That was a pretty cool way of incorporating a somewhat iconic historical event, and it wasn't too forced. When you get off the ship, you actually play as Aya. This section is when you play as her for the longest, and it lasts for about 30 minutes. Whatever she's doing, Bayek is there. Bayek could have been there, or she's doing Bayek's job. I can understand why we played as her for the naval sections, as Bayek couldn't have been involved with those, but to spring this on us 3/4 of the way through the game is so weird. Origins has very clearly been about Bayek's story, and Aya's been absent for most of that. On top of that, I don't even really like her. Don't get me wrong, I do sympathise with her, but there's not exactly anything to like about Aya. This is a really bizarre choice. I have no idea what Montreal 3 were going for, but sure. You're allowed to bring Cleopatra inside to Caesar himself, who's with two other men, Ptolemy and Flavius, who doesn't seem too important. Really, he doesn't seem important at all. After talking to Caesar for about 20 seconds, he seems to have come round to Cleopatra and takes her off to talk because he's a massive simp. I really fucking hate that word, but yeah, those two go off and we skip to the next day where we're playing as Aya again. She goes off with Bayek to unlock the tomb of Alexander the Great because Caesar wants to see it. Alexander was buried with his scepter, one of the staves of Eden, and that'll be important later. Flavius barges into the room looking as insignificant as ever to tell us that Caesar's emissaries have been captured. We go to rescue them and one of them tells us Septimius is planning an attack on the palace from the harbour. Caesar wants Bayek to light the forest to alert his fleet of what's going on, but Bayek lets Aya do it because because who cares about bike anyway? It is actually really cool seeing Alexandria so war-torn, and climbing the light house of Alexandria is maybe the only time the traversal is really that fun or engaging. We didn't even get parkour puzzles like this in Syndicate or Unity, so this was much appreciated. After Aya casts the die on the Pharos, we get a pretty cool bit of foreshadowing.
Many men have doubted Aya. All have found themselves dead by her blade.
And go off in this game's big set piece. You and Julius Caesar ride through Alexandria through all of this chaos as enemy soldiers try and like drive by you, ending with an elephant trying to run you off the road, and yeah, it's a decent enough set piece. We cut to 3 days later and I'm glad for that. The team had a chance for a massive scale battle and I'm glad they didn't take that. That's not really what the series is about and it just wouldn't have been necessary. Soon enough, we track down the jackal who's riding a huge fuck off elephant, and that makes for a double bill of elephant fights. I don't know that we needed that, but we got it anyway. The fight's alright, and Pothinus's confession is also really good. It shows us that like their more modern counterparts, the Order of Ancients aren't inherently evil, and some of them, like Pothinus, genuinely want a better world, even if Pothinus isn't a particularly good villain, and it's only ever clear in this one scene. After that, you get a boss fight with Septimius, and I really like both Septimius fights, as you're always on your feet and you can't really stay still for too long. After Bite gets the upper hand on Septimius, Caesar comes along and tells him to stop, as he wants to punish him under Roman laws. However, behind the scenes, Septimius is able to use his power to basically put him and Flavius in charge of both Egypt and Rome. Ptolemy also dies, Aya went to kill him, but of course historically she can't be the one to do it, so he gets eaten by crocodiles instead. With him gone, Cleopatra and Caesar rule, with what's left of the order basically pulling the strings. Bayek and Aya, frustrated, go back to their allies, which is when we get one of the most important scenes, not just in the game, but in the series.
I was wrong! I am responsible. When my boy died, I fought back with rage and anger. But this only made them stronger. We are all different. But we fought together to put Cleopatra on the throne. Now this was a mistake, my friends. But at least it brought us together. Now our enemies are hidden behind crowns, working in the shadows of kings and queens. Who are the ones that work in the shadows for the people? We are. Something has come of all of this, and it starts right now. We must continue the fight and defend the free will of the people. And no matter how small, our brotherhood is the only hope, and our kingdom needs no crowns. What we believe in, our values, our creed, will unify us. And I promise that for all the songs of Egypt, I will be the father I was not that day in Siwa. To the Brotherhood.
The Brotherhood!
This is pretty much the first scene where we start to see the groundwork for the hidden ones being laid, and it would have been very easy to get wrong, and a lot of people worry the team would get it wrong. I don't think they do. It makes sense why Bayek would want to do something like this, and it's a genuinely really emotional and impactful moment for Bayek, but also us as fans. Every time I hear Bayek talk about working in the shadows, it gives me chills. It's an incredible scene that's once again heightened by Shatner's soundtrack. All I will say is that for the origins of the assassins, it would have maybe been nice to know how Cleopatra did get the blade, or maybe if we heard something more about the proto assassins, but besides that, it's pretty good. After that, Bayek and Aya have sort of figured out that Alexander's staff is of some significance, so they go to the tomb to figure out why. Apollodorus is down there fighting with some soldiers, which is where he dies, but before that he tells us Flavius was the one behind it all, having killed Bayek's son and now taking the apple and scepter to the vault in Siwa. Flavius we'll get onto in a bit. Apollodorus himself, though, was an okay character. He and Bayek have a bit of banter, but that's about it. In general, I don't think the side characters in the game were really that good. Foxidus is somewhat memorable, so is Kensa, but besides Aya, none of the side characters are really that strong. In a game written by Darby, or maybe Corey, you tend to have a really strong cast of supporting characters, and I feel like scenes like this one would be better if these characters were stronger. Heading to Siwa is actually quite cool. It feels like everything has sort of come to a head, and by this point the story is moving really fast. And there's nothing really to get in your way. The atmosphere of like a foggy and broken Siwa is also really well done. By the time you reach the vault, it's too late as the Order have already seen the map, and Hepzifer trying to stop them was killed. Hepzifer's death doesn't really do anything for me, to be honest. He's established as Bayek's mate at the start of the game, and that's sort of it. You've spent hours upon hours apart from him by this point, and it's really easy to forget he even exists. Although, to be fair, you are given his epic fire sword with adrenaline unhurt, so all is forgiven in that regard. And with that, Bayek can head off with the prayers of his village to back his case.
Bayek! Aya! You have the prayers of the entire village to support you.
I mean, cheers, Rabbi, but I'm 4 levels below Flabby, so that's gonna do fuck all. Seriously though, level gaps to one side, which we will get to, you head off to Cairn Acre on this really immersive journey. Bayek is saying these really cool lines of dialogue, another brilliant Shakna piece kicks in, all as this momentum of the story culminates as Cairn Acre comes into view, and it's just amazing. It really feels like after all this time, you're just able to play through the story, and that feels great. The issue is, that doesn't last. After saving Praxilla, a citizen in the area, you're told where Flavius is, but that final quest has another level gap. By this point, I'm level 31, and the final weighing, this quest is a recommended level 35. I of course only go for level 33, but those two levels are an eternity. Each level takes 17,000 XP by this point, and the average side quest gives you about 2,000. So at this point, I have to go and do a ton more of these mind-numbing side quests I've been begrudgingly doing for the entire game. I have no clue why this roadblock was included here when the game finally has some momentum. It's literally the last level gap in the game, and sure, I could have played this on New Game Plus, but this is how you play the game the first time through and how it's intended to be played. The thing is, if you do use New Game Plus, you're cutting out so much content. Your two options are either to brave these dull, mindless activities that really hurt the flow of the game, or cut out over half of its content and have basically nothing to do once you've finished the game. The leveling in Origins is handled awfully. For me, it's one of the game's biggest issues, and one of many reasons I can't consider it a top tier AC, despite liking so much of it. After all that's out the way, you head into Cyrene, and I really do like Cyrene. It's really cool, and it's also where Bayek has his final showdown with Flavius, who is just terrible. His defining traits are that 1, he's a dickhead, and 2, he has a whiny voice. Fucking hell, Ubisoft may have just employed me. I know I'm complaining a lot, and I do still like this game, but Flavius is yet another typical AC mustache twirling villain. It's not even in the Cesare kind of way, where there's some sort of dynamic between him and the protagonist that makes it interesting or fun. He just sort of comes out of nowhere. My first time playing through the game, I really thought I'd miss something, but the story is just really poorly written in parts. Things like this and the death of Hepzifer act as if you, as the player, have far more investment or knowledge than you do, and as a result, both of these fall flat. You have a pretty decent boss fight with Flavius, and then a brilliant scene where Bayek finally lets go of Hemu.
Child Flavius! My child!
Now, that's the one thing I do not regret in my life.
I will never give you peace!
Your son's death made the Order bow to me! Caesar, even. I had Rome! It gave me an empire of 1,000 sons, each one greater than the last. Come on! Finish me! You coward! The waste of time!
Yeah, I can't do it! I can't do it!
It's all right, Papa.
No. I will lose you forever.
Not forever. I will be waiting for you in the field of reeds.
This is one of my favourite scenes in the game because it's the end to an arc for Bayek, and it's just tragic. Seeing a man so overtaken by grief that he doesn't even want to let go of that because it's all he has left of his son is genuinely heartbreaking, especially for a character I love as much as Bayek. And again, I have to praise Abubakar Salim for some of the best acting I've seen in any game. Bayek to me is why I said that I loved Origins so much, and if it wasn't for him being as strong of a character as he is, I don't know if I'd like Origins that much, but more on that in a bit. When you return to Aya and the Hidden Ones, you see Brutus, which is cool, even if he isn't in his armor. Aya plans on leaving for Rome, and Bayek speaks to her one last time, at least before the DLC.
Our victories have multiplied, our bond not so.
We could never have been. Everything has told us our love is impossible.
You are right. Something bigger has called us. But our love lives in the Duat.
Only now we are letting go.
Let the gods decide.
The gods are dead.
We must sacrifice our personal lives for the greater good. All this darkness was for a reason.
I was wrong to be so reckless in public without killing. We must work in the shadows.
Egypt has fallen. Greece also. And Rome will fall too. All will fall to the creed, yet no one will know.
When we assassinate only those who deserve it. The few sick souls who try to control us. But they will never know who we are. Cold, calculated, poets of the kill.
I am fine with this. I am not a father anymore. I am not a husband. I am not a Magi. I am a hidden one.
Yes. We are the hidden ones.
We sharpen our blades and pull what hope is left from this foul earth.
You off now.
A new creed. Ours is finished.
This scene is great. Even years later, after seeing it so many times, it still gives me chills. It's a huge payoff to Bayek's story, and getting to see the creation of the assassin insignia on top of that was absolutely insane, and once again the soundtrack is brilliant. A moment like this that's key in the Brotherhood's formation will be so easy to get wrong, and I'm glad it was done justice. Aya now heads to Rome to assassinate Caesar and Septimius. I'm really glad we actually got to go to Rome, even if it was just a courtyard and this arena you can only visit once. It's nice and it's far better than just cutscenes, so I really do appreciate the work put in there. The Septimius boss fight is pretty good, and his confession is fairly standard stuff. After that, you assassinate Caesar, with Brutus taking the final stab, which would be far cooler if he actually was using the dagger of Brutus, but it's fine enough. The confession is about what you'd expect. Caesar talks about being a god and about why Rome won't fall, basically embodying what the assassins fight, so it is a fitting final assassination to the game. To end off, Aya says Requiescat in Pace, which while on the nose isn't as forced as it was in Syndicate, as Aya is actually in a Latin-speaking country. Aya pays Cleopatra a visit where she doesn't assassinate her but just warns her, and that's not the actual retcon, as Cleopatra couldn't have died yet. In the final scenes of the game, we see Bayek and Tahira running across rooftops of Memphis and enacting justice. It's really cool to see, and it's even better that we get a bureau. As minor as it may be, just having smaller elements of the series be implemented here make it feel as if this is actually the birth of the Brotherhood. I really love all of this. Probably the most important part of the scene is discovering Aya is Amunet, in an odd way to say the least. She stares at the camera, says she's Amunet, which the subtitles show well before she says it, then pulls a Batman and teleports away. I know it's representative more than anything, it just feels a bit silly, and on the whole I feel it would have been far better if Aya gave herself the name Amunet on the beach, or if the whole scene wasn't just Elaine pointing at his plot twist, nudging you and telling you how totally epic all of this is. After that though, the game is basically done. So, Assassin's Creed Origins, is it still good? Yeah, I'd say so. While I can't say I love it as much as I used to, I still like the game. I just feel so much of the love for Origins was contextual. In my AC rankings video from earlier this year, I placed Origins at 3, very closely followed and interchangeable with Revelations and Black Flag, but after replaying the game without New Game Plus and setting biases aside, I don't think it's even in my top 5 anymore. After sitting down and writing this, laying out my thoughts, I realised that so much of my love for Origins is tied to Bayek. He's an excellently performed character and one of the most human protagonists we've seen so far. And when I think of Origins, it's Bayek that I think of first, and I overlook a lot of the game's flaws, both as a game and an Assassin's Creed game because of that, or at least they become smaller flaws. The reason that I say a lot of love for me and so many people in the community had for Origins is contextual is because at the time of release, it was a much needed change. People were burnt out or bored of the series and Ubisoft needed to shake things up. Even me, someone who adored Unity and was still enjoying the online of that game in 2017, wanted something new. And Origins was new, it was new and it was good, and that went doubly so for people who didn't like Unity and Syndicate, and there was a lot of those people. To put it in short, Origins felt like Ubisoft Montreal sweeping us off our feet and telling us Assassin's Creed was back. Back after years of being dead, and for so many of us, it gave us faith Assassin's Creed was revived, so to speak. Obviously, it wasn't, not just because Odyssey metaphorically killed the series again the next year, to go with the analogy, but because in a lot of ways, Origins isn't a very good Assassin's Creed game. Don't get me wrong, there's tombs, a soundtrack, and some phenomenal moments fitting of Assassin's Creed, but so much else is missing or wrong. For one, social stealth and meaningful traversal, two key elements of the series are absent, two things that strongly define the series' identity. As to things like eagle vision, an actually important modern day, and feeling like and being an assassin, which for almost the entirety of the game, you aren't. And even when you are, or sort of are, the gameplay doesn't complement that. I don't consider Origins that good as an Assassin's Creed game anymore because it throws away so much of what made the series what it is to embrace being an RPG. And at the time, that was a refreshing change of pace, but in 2020, it's what diluted the identity of the series so much. So much that it's hard to tell these are Assassin's Creed games anymore. Innovation is brilliant. You need to evolve a game as the industry evolves, but this isn't innovation. It's copying other successful games that do what Ubisoft tries to do much, much better. The point of evolving a series is to make it better, to keep the heart of the series and what made it special but move forward. This new RPG formula strips away parts of the series until it's an unrecognisable shell of what it used to be, which is an amazing and unique series of games. I get that all this sounds very pessimistic, it does, but I can't praise Origins under this false idea of innovation when it sent the series down a path that may well have doomed it. I liked Origins, and I'm sure I'll like Valhalla, but for the Assassin's Creed series, a series that used to be a trailblazer in the industry, seeing it distance itself from what made it brilliant to a far more generic and by-the-numbers series is just sad. With that said, Egypt is one of the most stunning, detailed, and all-round fun worlds the series has given us. Bayek has an incredibly tragic story, and in spite of that, is incredibly likeable and one of the series' best protagonists. Sarah Shackner's score is, again, beautiful and has great ambience to it. The tombs were quite good, and there's plenty of well-executed fan service. I have to reiterate, I like this game, it does a lot of things right, and I still love a lot of things that I did at launch, and after replaying it, I'd give it a strong 6 to a light 7. So thank you guys for watching this, I'm so glad to finally have this out, albeit far too late. I kept setting dates for this that I never met and I'm so sorry about that. It's just been difficult to keep putting out regular videos bi-daily or every 3 days, keeping up with things in real life and getting this done. The Syndicate review came out a good while ago, like at the end of May. It's been so long that a third of the people sub to me now were actually sub back then, which is insane. And thank you guys for the support, it's mental, we've just passed 10k, it's been insane. For the next review, I was thinking of doing Brotherhood for the 10-year anniversary, just so I can have it done and won't have to rush to make the anniversary date. I'll work on that differently to this and just chip away at it in the background while I work on other stuff. And anyway, if you guys enjoyed this, I'd really appreciate if you left a like, it genuinely helps a lot. And if you didn't enjoy this, maybe let me know why, that helps a lot too. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you all next time.